seeking you as a precious jewel. Lord, to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. My cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. When I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all.
Praise the Lord, let the earth Dear Heavenly Father, we come to you today, this morning, thankful for everything that you've done to us, for us, and that you have been able to lead us and guide us through your Holy Spirit. We ask and we pray this morning, especially for your young people, as they're starting a new year, a school, a uni, at TAFE, wherever they are at the moment, be with them, give them strength, and give them the strength to be Seventh-day Adventist and everything else after that. We ask for our elderly, give them the strength and relief, and also give them the ease that you're with them, and also be with everybody else that's in this church. Doesn't matter if they're for the first time or they're members of this church. We ask this morning for all the people in this world, as the virus is spreading, especially for people in China, in cities where they're closed, for all the people. But the main message that's in all of this is give us the strength so we can tell your health message. It is most important at this time, so that we might be able to tell them what you gave us, the message, and to everybody else, so that we can stop this kind of diseases. We also pray for the scientists in Geelong and in China, so that they may find the cure and that this coronavirus may spread, may stop spreading as fast as it is. I ask also for Brother Bob, as he's leading us in sermon, in the message. Give him the wisdom and the strength so that the message that you will give us through him can lead us and give us the food for our heart, for our mind, that we can be your people and spread your message to this world. We ask all this in your name. Amen.
Okay, good morning, boys and girls. Good morning, boys and girls.
Good morning.
That's more like it. You guys, you still sleeping? What? What's going on? Is everything okay? Mom and dad are too harsh, are they? It's all right. You can come and live with Uncle Andrew. It's all right. You can have whatever you want. Okay, thank you. Anyway, I'd like to welcome you guys to our children's story. This morning, my friends, I've got a nice story. I think this is the best story that has been said in this church. I don't know, you'll probably be the judge of that, but anyway, I'll tell you, it's about a seven-year-old girl. A seven-year-old what?
Girl.
She was from the vast plains of Botswana. How many of us know where Botswana is? Have you ever heard of Botswana?
No.
You have? Have you been there?
No.
Not yet? Okay. So Botswana is on the continent of Africa. How many of us are from Africa here? All of us, right? That's right. Anyway, so Botswana has the Kalahari Desert. Say Kalahari Desert. Kalahari Desert. So when you go home, just say, Mom and Dad, I want to Google. I want to find out where Kalahari Desert is because I want to go there. Because you know what's at the Kalahari Desert? That's it. No one knows. No one, man, you're a smart guy. They're animals. So there's a delta there. And at the delta, you find all the animals you can think of. We're talking about hippos. We're talking about elephants. We're talking about all sorts of animals you can think of are there. And even meerkats. Who knows a meerkat? You know what a meerkat is? Meerkats are there. They even have hyenas. Have you ever seen a hyena before? What do hyenas do? They always laugh, right? Yeah? That's what hyenas do. Can you imagine? I'll tell you next time. I'll tell you a story about when I was walking in the jungle in Africa. Now I'm kidding. Never been in the jungle before, but anyway. So this story is about this seven-year-old girl named Tibogo. What's her name?
Tibogo.
That's right. You see, my friends, Tibogo, she felt sad twice in her life. The first time she felt sad was when her mother gave her money. When her mother gave her what?
Money.
How many of us are given money all the time? All of us? Or mom and daddy are stingy? I thought so. I knew they were stingy. My goodness. We'll talk to them later, all right? So what happened was, mom gave her money for the first time, but she was sad about it. So mom asked her, okay, Tibogo, you can go and get your favorite popcorn. So she loved popcorn. You know that flavored popcorn that makes your mouth watery? So she was so excited, and she went to the store to get the popcorn. I'll give you a chance. Let me finish. Is popcorn your favorite? Okay, good. I'll talk to your dad about it later. So on her way to get a popcorn at the store, she was super excited. She was jumping for joy. She was saying, yes, I'm going to get popcorn. And then she met four boys. Four what? Four boys, Noah and her friends, and his friends. And, yeah, one, two, three, four, right? Yeah, four boys. And they said to Tibogo, hey, Tibogo, give us that money. And Tibogo, she didn't want to give her money away because this was her first time, that's right, first time getting money from mom. And she was excited to go and get her popcorn. And then all of a sudden what happened was she started to cry and refused to give her money away because this was her first time. Imagine $5. She was like, yes, I'm going to eat so much popcorn. But then one of the boys, I think it was Noah, slapped Tibogo and took the money away from her. And she felt so sad. She felt what? So sad. She felt so sad about it. And then she went home and the mom saw her crying and said, what happened to Bogo? And she said, Mom, my money was taken away from me. And I didn't get an opportunity to buy my popcorn. So then what happened next was that the mom saw how sad her daughter was because she had said, I don't want to go back to school, to that school anymore. So what happened was the mom said to her, don't worry. After your first grade, after you finish, which was not long after, I will move you to a different school. And so it did happen. Mom moved away from that school, and she went to a Seventh-day Adventist school over in Botswana. So in Botswana, when you guys go there, and when you convince your parents to go there, there are three Seventh-day Adventist schools there. So, and this school is called Eastern Gate Primary School. So that's where mom took her daughter. And then you know what? The first day, you know what Tibogo said? I'm so happy I'm in this school because the teacher teaches me how to behave, how to be good girls and boys, and how to obey my parents, she said. Then the second time, before we close our interesting story, the best story that has ever been said in this church. Are you listening? Are you listening? Do I have your attention? This is the best part now. Then we pray. The second time she got sad was when her grandparents came to the house. You see, the grandparents were so old. They were so what? They were so old. So when they were talking, they always forgot what they were talking about. How many of us got grandparents do that? Okay, some of us were a bit shy, a bit sensitive about that. But anyway, listen. Tibogo felt so sad about her grandparents. Imagine, you're Jake, right? And this is your brother, Ben. Right, okay. Imagine, Ben, you're sad about your grandparents that they're forgetting. So what happened was Mom saw that Tibogo was sad. And she said, you know what, Tibogo? The key to all of this is that you pray. Because you know what this reminded her of? Was when that boy slapped her. It made her very sad. So the same thing here, we find that Tibogo was sad because, and it made her so unhappy because her grandparents were forgetting what they were talking about. So what did Tibogo do? She started to pray. She started to what? To pray. As she began to pray, she prayed for her grandparents. And I think she also prayed for those boys that slapped her too. And then, as she began to pray, she started praying early in the morning. Her and her sister would wake up early in the early hours of the morning, and they would pray for the grandparents. And do you know what happened? God answered the prayer. The grandparents, as they started to talk, they didn't forget. They remembered. It was a miracle. And you know what this taught her? That God does answer prayers. God does what? He answers prayers. So if there's anything in your life that's happening, remember this, that you, when you pray to God, God will answer your what? Your prayers. Because prayer is important. Prayer is what? Important. So what, my friends, before we close, this made Tibogo very happy. It made Tibogo what? Very happy. And she says that, I felt happy and thank God, she said. So now the lesson that she learned today, it's a true story, by the way. Today, as we speak, Tibogo wakes up every morning to pray to God. Every morning. So what does this teach us, my friends? What should we do? Thank you, Noah. Pray. We need to wake up in the morning and pray. I know we're all sleepy, you know, we're probably going to school, but whenever we wake up, we need to say, hey, Mom, I think we forgot to pray. Or Dad, maybe. But dads never forget anything, right? So, my friends, this is the end of our story. So what did we learn today? God answers prayers. When you're sad, you talk to God. And God answers our prayers. And this helps us to communicate to God all the time. And another thing we learned about Botswana, where we're going to go for holiday this year, right? Okay, let us pray. Father, thank you, Lord, for this young people, Lord. As they are growing, Lord, we ask that as they become sad or feel some type of way, we pray that your hand may be upon them, that they may be strong, Lord, that they may love you, and they may lean on you, and they may want to follow you. So please pray a special blessing for these young people. Help them to be strong. Help them to continue to grow, and that they may follow your will. As we pray this in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for that interesting story from Botswana. One thing I like in the Adventist Church is it's a worldwide church. And this week our offerings are going to local church budget. As well as that, as the deacons come forward, you will notice with the offering bags, there is a red and a blue. The blue is for the loan development, repayment offering, and the other one is for local church. This is our opportunity to give back in thanks to God for the wonderful blessings that He has given us. If you could bow your heads in prayer, please. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this opportunity that we can give back to you. There are many times that we are thankful for the blessings, and we just ask that these offerings will go and help further your work. In your name we pray. Amen.
I don't understand it all, the heavy burden, the raging battle, endless fight. I don't see a way for God to lead me through it, through what seems to be an
where angry billows cease. Through it all I stand in freedom. Surrender to the everlasting peace. There's a well of living water in the desert. Inside his arms, yet I'll rise beyond the tempest to a place where angry billows cease. Through it all, I stand in freedom, surrender to everlasting peace. Never distant, always near, ever present, God is near. Yet I rise beyond the tempest where angry billows cease. Through it all I stand in freedom. Surrender to the everlasting peace. Surrender to the everlasting peace. Surrender to
everlasting peace. Folks, I don't know which is more nervous. Standing in crowd and crawl on a Saturday night with about 200 or 300 people, and Saturday morning with God's people. I think this occasion is more, I wouldn't use the word confronting, but it's a bit of a nervous experience when I see the church full like this. And I'm glad, friends, that God has spoken to each and every one of you today to come to church and hear the message, to hear the word of God. Friends, I'd just like to, thanks Pastor Zenny. Pastor Zenny, I know it's not an easy task to give the pulpit away, but I'm glad you saw fit and you gave this a consideration to be able to present the message this morning. And I know from Brother Zenny, it was not to be a decision taken lightly. And I just pray, beloved, that I'm a vessel, just an ordinary guy, just like you out there, boys, men. And I pray that God will use me and that you will see and hear God and not Bob Vickery. Amen. Friends, today I will be specific, is that how you say it? It's a bit of a tongue twister, but you know what I mean. Direct, and above all, transparent. Is that okay? Amen. And I pray, friends, that we can still be friends at the end of today's service. As you can see, friends, the witness of the church, its importance, the witness injured by inconsistencies. Just take a moment and look at that as I do the task of Pastor Zinni has given me to introduce the book of Acts. And he's given me the task of presenting Acts chapter 1. But before we get into that, friends, we'll just bow our heads and open with a word of prayer. Our loving Father in heaven, we pray that today you will speak to the hearts of those who came to listen to you. Father, we know that this message The three angels message, the Adventist message is a life and death message. We want to be serious this morning, Lord, and we can only be like that if the presence of the Holy Spirit is dwelling amongst us. I pray, dear God, that you will touch the hearts of the people and that they may see and hear you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. The book of Acts, friends. When Pastor Zenny said we're doing a series on the book of Acts, I didn't know what to expect, but he's given me the chapter one. I'm just going to go through it and break it down and make it simple, the best way the Holy Spirit has impressed me to do it. And this is before I actually get into the main gist of the message, friends. And I think it's only fair that if we don't know what the book of Acts is all about, you know, it's only right to know what it is all about. The book of Acts, friends, tells the exciting story of the beginning of the church. Acts is a pivotal book of the New Testament, for it continues a story told in the Gospel and explains the truths declared in the epistles. Amen, brother? See you shaking your head. The book of Acts not only tells about the church of the first century, it also provides information and inspiration to those who would seek to be the church in the 20th century. And beloved Christians today have searching questions. What is the church? What is our power? What is the purpose, our purpose? What is our source of power? And how are we to relate to each other, to the Word, to God? Friends, answers to these questions can be found in the book of Acts. Well, what is the book of Acts all about? The title by which the book is commonly known is the Acts of the Apostles, and if you want to go another step further, the Acts of the Holy Spirit. The emphasis is on that. The central theme of Acts is that God was doing something in the world in Jesus Christ that nobody or nothing could stop. The book of Acts focuses on God's work through the church, and these churches of Acts were not perfect. They were like our churches today. They had their flaws and their conflicts, and each was unique. These churches were a vital part of the inauguration of the Christian faith. And beloved, these Christian preachers proclaimed the gospel message, explained its application, and challenged the listeners to respond to it. And friends, I believe that that's what Pastor Zenny would like everyone to be able to do by the end of the series on Acts, to be able to respond to it and make it applicable in your own personal life. As I've told you folks, I've been given the task of presenting chapter one of Acts. And what I've done, I've just simply broken it down into four parts. Acts 4, verses 4 to 8, the Holy Spirit promised. Verses 9 to 11, Jesus ascends to heaven. 12 to 14, the upper room prayer meeting. And 15 to 26, Matthias chosen, replacing Judas. And friends, today's message I'll be focusing on verse 8. I've come into this with a different angle to make it applicable. The title of the sermon is The Witness of the Church, Its Importance. And friends, there is a controversy going on. You know, there's two spirits at play here. We have the Holy Spirit, the God-given Spirit, and we have the counterfeit Spirit, the Satan Spirit. The witness is injured by inconsistencies. Which one are we, my friend? Are we bearing false witness? Are we like Judas and have that devil spirit within him? And we know what happened to Judas. Now, the book of Proverbs says that he or she who lives in sin is dead, and he who remains in the congregation of the dead, the Holy Spirit will not fall upon them. And so I said, friends, I just want to be direct and transparent and straight to the point. It's not my intention this morning to offend anyone. The Word of God does offend, friends, if you don't want to hear the truth. But the Word of God is also into healing. Before we go any further, friends, I'd just like to share with you some, not my thoughts, but the thoughts of our World Conference leader, Ted Wilson, in regards to the mission for the church, the importance of it, which ties in, friends, with the title of the service today. Throughout the whole message, friends, the emphasis will be to do with the witness of the church and to see where you are as an individual in the body of the church. Are you doing the work that Jesus Christ has called you to do? And Ted Wilson, addressing our worldwide church, he said he felt impressed to speak out in a much stronger way on certain subjects that are removing us from God's mission for this remnant church. God's mission for this church. We need to be filled with the Holy Spirit, friends. You know that text, can I bring that text up on the screen, guys, up there? The Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Are you able to do that? If not, we can go to the Word of God. Acts chapter 1. If you have your Bibles, friends, let's go to Acts chapter 1 and verse 8, because this is the verse I'll be focusing on. Here we go. It says, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Now in the middle there, friends, you will see that the word, when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. There's a condition, friends. Do you agree with that? When. Keep that in mind, please. He goes on to say, "I've just taken a handful of concerns he has for our church, and what would I know?" We're listening here to the World Conference leader, Ted Wilson, and everything he says, friends, ties in with the Bible and spirit of prophecy, so you cannot deny it. He says, "The loss of Seventh-day Adventist identity amongst..." I'm just generalising, friends, I'm not picking out any certain individual. He says, "Identity amongst our pastors and church members and the growing tide of worldliness and disunity and a spiritual complacency and apathy which leads to a lack of involvement in the church." Worldwide mission, friends, you need to be involved. And this is a concern that you're seeing, lack of involvement. He says, "The growing tide of worldliness in our churches is alarming, allowing the world to shape its thinking. Standards once cherished by Seventh-day Adventists, example," he says, "diet, dress, recreation, amusement, and Sabbath keeping are fast becoming things of the past. Members adorn like the world, dress like the world, love the world's entertainments, and listen to the world's music, and are captivated by its Hollywood productions." This is a concern that our worldwide leader has. And he says, "Spirituality erodes and the devil makes inroads into the soul." Whether we like it or not, friends, God is going to have a pure church. And the last message, messages of Christ's righteousness preached, my friends, will bring separation amongst God's people. And then the church will go forth with a loud cry. The Holy Spirit promised, when? Another one he has a concern for. This may be sensitive to some folks. He says, "Resist styles, worship styles and music, which have more to do with self-centeredness, self-centered entertainment, more so than a humble worship of God. Everything should be done," we know this, friends, "should be done to bring glory to God and not to the participants." Amen. Another concern he has, he says, "Avoid the practice of inviting major spiritual speakers who are not Seventh-day Adventists." That seems rather bold, doesn't it? "Avoid having them speak at men's and women's meetings, camp meetings, retreats, pastoral meetings and youth and church meetings." Why? I think we all, if we want to be honest, we will admit it, that we know why. But sometimes we bypass it. because they have no clear concept of Adventism, the three angels' message, and the Sabbath. Number five, he says, guard against. This is one that's probably so subtle that, you know, the devil, he's the greatest arch-deceiver. He's a master of it. Guard against the spiritual formation and the emerging church with its mystical beliefs and practices, a religion whose emphasis is based on experimental and emotional rather than a strong foundation on the Word of God. And friends, hence Hillsong type of music, type of worship, sorry, which involves music. And I see their methods being introduced into our church. Not only this church, friends, more so probably in other churches. I'm a member of this church, and as any individual, we observe what's taking place within our church. Some of it's very good, but some of it's not so good. But that's how it is, friends. It's a lukewarm Lotus Laodicea. It's a lukewarm church. But God has his faithful people in here. The Laodicean church, friends, is not the remnant church. The remnant are somewhere in here. Another concern, last one of many, he says disunity. Selected Messages, book 2, page 159, he says, unity, the book says, unity is the strength of the church. You believe that, folks? And if we allow the devil to attack, the church will not effectively accomplish its meeting, its mission. And there are many ways in which the devil attacks the church. I don't even have to begin to announce some of them. You know what causes disunity. And it's happening within our churches. But beloved, I want to tell you today that one of the powerful keys to success and power in our churches and in our pulpits and in evangelism is resolute faithfulness to the Word of God and to the message that God has given us to preach. And friends, we are now facing an unusual time in which those on the inside of our church are questioning our distinctive teachings and doctrines more than those who despise us. And many of us are walking away from the mandate that God gave us that he did not give to Billy Graham and company. I told you, friends, this morning I will be direct, I'll be transparent. Take it or leave it. It's the Word of God. It's not arrogance. The truth has to be presented in its entirety and in its simplicity. You know, we must preach our message, friends. All of it, not just some of it. We must preach all of the message. And friends, there are forces that seem to be dismantling what was so glorious put together under the indispensable aid of the Holy Ghost, Holy Spirit. And there is this picture of erudition, which is just a big fancy word for great academic knowledge, which we carelessly call scholarship. But it's more scholasticism. Let me explain, friends. Let me explain. Those words, they sound rather big and fancy, don't they? You know, the Word of God never contradicts itself. It is man that contradicts themselves. They contradict one another. That's what happens, friends. You know, I remember C.D. Brooks, and he quoted from Scripture in Ephesians. You know, God made ministers, pastors, preachers, prophets, evangelists, but man made theologians. And they think they are smarter than the Bible and the Spirit of prophecy. Ellen White says, except we have the truth as that God lives, and friends, she spoke of a platform of truth. She knew that it would always be gathering sources and resources, but she said, don't get off the platform. The Holy Spirit is not one to foster confusion. Amen? And he does not divide the saints. He may bring separation from the mixed multitude, but not from the saints. Friends, sorry if this seems personal to you, but in amongst us, there are those who appear to be tired of our message, bored with it. There is a swelling cry for something different, something unique. Some are saying we want a modern message that is designed for young people. But friends, that doesn't go along with the awesome prophecy of Malachi 4. For when the Elijah message comes just before the great and dreadful day of the Lord, the Bible says the hearts of the fathers and the children will be turned together. We are not to be divided by age and generation. You know, friends, the media uses the term simulcast, meaning that they are broadcasting in English and, for example, maybe Spanish and other languages at the same time, but bearing glory, friends, the gospel is coming down simulcast. A preacher man says, he said, I preached to little children that have come up to me and said, I enjoyed your sermon, Pastor. And I thought it was too heavy for them. Beloved, this loose liberalism does not accomplish what we think it will accomplish. Once again, friends, I'm emphasizing that this only happens if we're not filled with the right spirit. When the Holy Spirit comes upon you, we know sometimes the latter rain may be falling down right around us, friends, and we don't know. George Whittle, a journalist writing in Washington Magazine, says, the churches that make the greatest doctrinal and moral demands on their members, and he mentions the evangelical and fundamentalist Protestants, he says they are growing. Their churches are booming. In contrast, he says, the churches that have a hard time telling you why you ought to be a Christian, he goes on to say the churches of the old main line, like the Episcopalians, the Methodists, the Presbyterians, and the United Church of Christ, have been hemorrhaging congregants since the mid-60s. He says it is vanilla Protestantism that is dying, pure. And then he said, friends, theological friendliness, avant-garde worship, which is just another word for experimental and new methods of worship, and political correctness are a prescription for ecclesiastical catastrophe amongst the Christian church, that word ecclesiastical. And millions are leaving because they have no good reason to stay. A preacher man gives a testimony. He says, a young girl came into his office at one of their colleges where he was preaching, and he said that she burst into tears, sobbing uncontrollably. And she said, Pastor. And when the pastor asked her for a problem, she said, my parents don't love me. And the pastor said, well, how can you say that? They are sacrificing to keep you here, and you are dressed very well. They are taking good care of you. Why do you say that? She said, because they don't care about what I do. They don't care what I do. Beloved, young and old need the discipline of the Word of God. And beloved, when people feel like they can do whatever they please, then the church loses its premium value. They figure we don't care. But friends, feel-goodism is superficial happiness, momentarily, only lasts momentarily, friends. It's pervading, is present, spread throughout our churches, friends. And it's spreading in our churches and in our schools, and our churches and schools, friends, whether we like or not, are floundering. The devil, my friend, is pleading every device. Culture, along the lines of human intellect achievement, pluralism, the values and practices of society which tend to override the Word of God, and scholarship, education, which I just spoke briefly on about. But the Bible has an answer for that, my friend. God says, I am the Lord. I change not. I am the same yesterday and today and forever. Malachi 3:6, Hebrews 13, verse 8. The sad fact is, friend, there's a lot of talk about, well, we need someone to make Scripture relevant. I don't mean to be arrogant, friends, but if God said it, it's relevant. You know, friends, it's our unrelated ideas about what he said that are irrelevant. And Paul said, beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit. Colossians 2:8. Beloved, the preaching of the word, even with love and tact and diplomacy, will inevitably cause confrontation with our sinful carnal nature. You hear that, friends? I hear so many times, you need to preach the word with love. You need to be tactful. Yes, I believe that there is a time and place for that. But inevitably, friends, it will cause confrontation with our sinful carnal nature. And usually that wins out, the flesh. And friends, we are not called to make the word popular. Amen? But preach it with power. You know, I remember the old war horses. Friends, I've been in this church 60 years coming up next month. And I've listened to many preachers over the past via American Cassette Ministry up at Big Camp. And guys like C.D. Brooks, Earl Cleveland, George Vanderman and company. These men, they stood up with the burden for the right under the aegis of the Holy Ghost, and it poured out upon them, friends. We've got to confront our people for their sake. Not pamper them. And friends, if you pamper them, you're not helping them. We've got to dare to guide them. You know, friends, some of what they are doing is because they don't know any better. We've got to guide them concerning where they ought to go, what they ought to do, what they ought to wear, what they ought to think. And friends, we ought to do it with the word of God and the spirit of prophecy. And for 1 second, friends, get that thought out of your head. I'm talking about salvation by works. That's not the case. That's a cop-out. It's an entirely different story. And friends, when we talk to our people, it's not a purely human-to-human encounter. There is a person called the Holy Ghost. It's our privilege to have him standing by us and moving out there in the congregation, and he will take a difficult truth and he will apply it to the heart. Friends, you don't think I have to give up things that I've liked? Friends, I'd rather save one person with the Holy Ghost than comfort a church full of people in their self-deception. And friends, we fail our people when we water down and compromise and undermine and repudiate the message that God has given us to bear and to live. Friends, we cannot be filled with the Holy Spirit and do the mission that God has called us to do. We mean some areas of our life need to be rectified with the help of the Holy Spirit. Not only that, friends, we embolden them. That's just another word for encourage them. We're talking about young people, anybody in particular. We defy them to defy our standards. We encourage them to defy our standards. We embolden them to follow their own whims and offend fellow church members and even their parents. And many of them have chips on their shoulders. They are so self-conscious, self-confident, they dare you to say anything. Preacher Man says, another experience, he goes, a young woman who had always been friendly came to church one day, loaded down with jewelry. And he says, when I approached, ready to speak, she wouldn't even look. She had a problem. She avoided me. She couldn't even be friendly as usual. And friends, no wonder our churches are turning cold. It's lukewarm as it is. It's because our members remain guilt-ridden and insecure and not sure of what they really stand for. They hear about easy divorce, about moral falls in the ministry and in the leadership, Sabbaths on the beach, in the restaurant, theatre going, attacks on the spirit of prophecy. What is happening amongst us, friends? Now, this is solemn, friends. This is solemn and solid. Ellen White says, of all the sins God will punish, of all the sins God will punish, none is more grievous in his sight than the sin of causing others to do wrong. I say it again, of all the sins that God will punish, none are more grievous in his sight than those that encourage others to do evil. Patriarchs and Prophets, page 323. And of all the groups of people on the top side of the earth, friends, who's that? None has such an awesome responsibility resting upon it, as well as a privilege, as a Seventh-day Adventist ministry. And friends, when I read that, I also pray for our ministers. You know, ministers, preachers, laymen, whoever gets up here and preaches the word needs to give the trumpet a certain sound. And we're told in great controversy the day will come when people have realized that they've been lost because they were not told the truth, the full truth, and they turn against their ministers, and in their rage, there is bloodshed. Friends, that is serious. I'm not sensationalizing, friends. I'm not being radical. I'm just presenting to you the word of God and the spirit of prophecy. Friends, when I was a boy, you know, we grew up on a farm and went to a little country church. And about once every 6 weeks, we had a pastor come and preach the word. But today, beloved, there's a pastor every week. And we ask the question, you know, is the Holy Ghost still with us? Great topic, Pastor Zenny, for the next X amount of weeks. And many who feel a lack of the Spirit are trying to compensate with a shaking, rocking, rollicking religion. They want to feel real good. And this will replace their faith. But beloved, that will be wiped out in a crisis. The Bible says, friends, there is no peace save my God to the wicked. Isaiah 57:21. And beloved, many of our people who love the truth but don't know what to love are getting caught up in the subjective, ecstatic experience. And 11 o'clock service is like cocaine, a temporary fix. And before the sun set, they are right back to where they were, unhappy, critical, and not doing so well. And what do I want now? Then the devil suggests, he's listening, he's watching, he says, a loud, thumping, bumping religion. And I hear him say, it will cause me great delight in making the old saints uncomfortable. And friends, I've noticed that and observed that over the years in our church. It does make the old saints uncomfortable. And friends, we are being divided. We are not supposed to set our churches on fire. That's the work of the Holy Ghost. What are we supposed to do? We are to be repairers of the breach. That is something that you've broken. Repair it. Restorers of past to dwell in, says Isaiah 58:12. You know, questioning things that have already been worked out by the Holy Ghost. You know, friends, in human delivery, in mine and in yours, there will always be some excess baggage. But don't throw away everything. The apostle said, prove all things and hold fast that which is good. 1 Thessalonians 5:21. And instead, my friends, many are trying to satisfy themselves rather than pray and study. They want to reason things out with unsanctified minds. They're starting, friends, from the wrong position and will never arrive at spiritual fulfillment, but rather at a compounded delusion. You know, I'm reminded what Scripture says. It says, if a man refuses to believe the truth, God will send him what? A strong delusion that he should believe a lie. You know, friends, they tell me that when a man is drowning, he'll grab anything. He'll even grab a brick that's thrown to him and he'll cling to that brick. But no matter how sincere his grasp is on that brick, if all he has is a brick, friends, he's going to surely drown. For spiritual things, friends, are spiritually discerned. My Bible says, friend, if our gospel be hid, it is hid to them that are lost. 2 Corinthians 4:3. Friends, the gospel is good news. Amen. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born. Good news, the chariots are coming. Good news, the chariots are coming. Good news, the chariots are coming. And I don't want to be left behind. Amen. You don't want to be left behind, friends. This gospel of the word of the Lord is good news. And friends, if I don't find it explicitly from the Bible, where do I go? I get it indirectly from the spirit of prophecy, for the spirit of prophecy is biblical. And if it's not, we ought to throw it away. And in time of tension, danger, and crisis and judgment, God required, I'm under social reform here, friends. You want the Holy Spirit to fall upon you? There are certain things in our lives we need to give away, friends. Social reform, we have health reform. That's what distinguishes us from many other denominations, is the three angels' health message. And then there's social reform. And we see in Genesis 35, 2 to 4, when Jacob was trying to get home, they had to stop and bury some strange gods. They had to take off their earrings. And God says, strip yourself, take it off, that I may know what to do unto you. And the Bible says they stripped themselves of their ornaments by Mount Horeb. And you know, friends, there's one man who stood between the people's destiny and God. And who was that man? Moses. He stood between God and his people, and finally the wrath of God only murmured on the periphery of his consent. And God didn't say, it's all right. What did he say? Take it off. Strip it off. Beloved, we've been in the judgment since 1844. And the Bible says that those that didn't afflict themselves would be cut off. Before 1844, since 1844 to now, we're in the judgment. And those who don't afflict themselves, not might be, not maybe, will be cut off. Now, the preacher man gives another example. He says, I loved it when you could look at a young lady and know she was an Adventist. He says, he was invited to a camp meeting. He went into a town and didn't know what to do or where to go. He says, my wife says, honey, stop and phone in. Then it dawned on me, he said, that no one answers the phone at a campground on the Sabbath. At least they used not to answer it. He says, I was desperate. He says, I looked at a car easing by and I saw some women, their faces clean. They looked like something. And he pulled his car into that lane and he followed them. And the wife says, honey, what are you doing? The pastor said, I'm following those people. Do you know who they are? No, I just know how they look. And the pastor arrived at his destination. Think about it, my friend. Once again, we're talking about social form. You want the falling of the Holy Spirit to come upon you, friends. In our music, we got to be careful that we are not praising the devil instead of God, friends. You know, Alan White says that Satan dialogues with his imps. They discuss their plans together. His craftiness, he knows, will not fly unless he can first discount the spirit of prophecy. In Selected Messages, book 2, page 36, she says, the Lord, who? The Lord has shown me what would take place just before the close of probation. Every uncouth thing will be just demonstrated. Every uncouth thing will be just demonstrated, friends. Uncouth is another word for evil, if you like, if you please. They will be shouting. There will be shouting with drums, music, and dancing. The senses, listen to this, the senses of rational beings will become so confused they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. Now, friends, when I read that, I saw rational. Well, you know, I like to think everybody in here is rational. That's a positive word. You know, you're switched on, you're in control, you know what you're doing, you know what's right and what's wrong. But here it says the senses of rational beings will become so confused that they cannot be trusted to make right decisions. And this is called the moving of the Holy Spirit. Once again, the inconsistencies, witnessing to the church, Holy Spirit. Friends, I don't get up here very often, and I'm not in the habit of making a statement, using the pulpit to make a statement, but I'd just like to share a personal opinion. You know, over the years as a young man and growing up as a young adult, I loved to go to big camp. I know a lot of people love going to big camp. Wonderful time, wonderful experience, fellowshipping with people of like faith. And I enjoyed going to the big camp, big tent especially. Because when Neil Watts was in leadership, he used to bring out these really powerful speakers. C.D. Brooks, just to name one of many. But sadly, when the man stepped down, that's never been the same again. That's my personal opinion, my friend. The Word of God needs to be preached and presented in its most dynamic form to move the hearts of the people. Because inevitably, it will clash with our human nature if you have love, love, love all the time. It's just a personal opinion. Take it or leave it. A little more from selected messages. She says, a bedlam of noise shocks the senses and perverts that which, if conducted all right, might be a blessing. Gospel music, my friends, should be a blessing. Amen. Amen. But you, friends, you know it's all out of hand. I don't believe the drum is a bigger sinner than the trumpet, the keyboard, the guitar, the saxophone, etc., etc. It's what we do with it. So you know what Satan did? He had a huddle. And he said to his imps, let's develop crossover. Why would a saint want to cross over? Let's develop crossover, said the devil. Let's blend some of ours with some of theirs. And let's start off with a balance, and then let's get gradually move off center, and then let's talk about Christian jazz and religious gospel rock. These are contradictions of terms, you see. Let's get them moving and grooving like our crowd in our places. And when they are getting down, then as we get them moving so that their senses cannot be trusted, let's pull out all the stops. That's what the devil says, friends. You know, this word, music, M-U-Z-A-K, there's M-U-S-I-C, and there's M-U-Z-A-K. I know some of you know what I'm talking about here. And one scholar from Australia writing about this phenomenon said that it's taking place here and there and everywhere. It's just a stimulus, progressive type of music. It's background music, elevated music, shopping centre music. And this man says that music is one force that does not have to pass through the judgment hall of the brain before it affects us. There's an organ at the base of the brain to which music appeals directly. You don't even have to think to start moving. That's how M-U-Z-A-K became successful. It was background music. Folk didn't even know what they were listening to. It just soothed them. And now, friends, they're doing it with light rock. And M-U-Z-A-K is gone. And friends, we ought to know that Satan would take advantage of a thing like this and captivate and enchant us. You know, friends, we were once upon a time known as masters and purveyors of good music of various kinds. We were known for that music, both classical and dignified, warm and moving and simple. Ellen White says in Object Lessons, page 316, she says, the line of demarcation is becoming indistinct. Satan starts out small. No one comes to a sudden ruin. It takes time to corrupt the soul, and gradually the devil perverts. One departure from principle begins a journey. Friends, that's the flesh. The flesh is always marching on downwards, debauching every noble impulse until a man or a woman has reached a level he never, ever, or her, she thought possible for him or herself. That the flesh reigns. And the devil has control of you. Friends, who do you think we're dealing with? He's called the wily foe. He's no friend of ours. He names these coffin nails called cigarettes. You know, they've got all these fancy names for them. I don't smoke, and I know a lot of you don't. Hopefully everyone doesn't smoke. But, you know, they've got these really fancy names, eh? Make it so attractive. They seem to bypass what it does to you on the packet. Who do you think we're dealing with, friends, when he names the poisons of alcohol, such as, you know, Southern Comfort, you know, Bundy Rum, Ouzo, etc., etc.? And again, I know we all don't drink. And God says a good tree cannot what? I had the text up there before, but it hasn't come up yet. But God says a good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit. Neither can an evil tree bring forth good fruit. The Holy Spirit, friends, there's a true spirit and there's a counterfeit spirit. And if we are to be the mission of the church to the world, we have to make sure we are with the true spirit, not the counterfeit spirit. He's a touchy one, friends. I'm getting to the end. Please bear with me. Movies. If you say anything about them, you're old-fashioned. Call me old if you want, beloved. But God is older than I am. And when God tells us something, he gets it right, friends, the first time. He doesn't have to edit or adjust. Preacher man once says, he gives an experience, he says, I used to sneak off to the movies and finally one of his buddies was with him and he says, we didn't know what else to do, so he took me to hear a skinny preacher by the name of Earl Cleveland. He says, all in 2 weeks' time, something happened. I thank the Lord God, he says. One Sabbath, I walked out of that man's meeting, that buddy of his and I, he says, and headed to the Carolina Theatre. The sun was going down, sparsely had gone, but nobody made me feel comfortable about it. My own conscience wouldn't let me feel comfortable about it. And he said, finally, we walked about 7 blocks. The theatre was across the street. The red light stopped us, and we were walking, discussing what we heard in the man's tent. And I started thinking. And he says, all of a sudden, the light turned green, and he started off. His buddy started off. And I stayed. He turned around and he said, what's wrong with you? I said, I'm not going. And he said, what do you mean you're not going? The preacher man said, you know the things that you're learning? I already know. I can't go, for I know them already. My buddy said, if you don't go, I don't go. And beloved, that preacher man said, that was 47 years ago. And today that man is a deacon in the Adventist church. His wife and daughters are officers in the church. And he said, suppose I hadn't stopped. You want to witness, friends, for the truth? Do the right thing. Not in your own strength, of course. Beloved, we serve a timeless God. And time, as we know it, is about to experience a cataclysmic collision with eternity. We are about to enter his realm of time and space. But when we do, beloved, truth will still be the truth. Sabbath will still be the Sabbath. Why? Because the truth never dies. Though ages come and go, though mountains wear away and seas retire, destruction lays earth's mighty golden cities low, and empire states and dynasties expire, but caught and handed onward to the wise, truth never dies, my friend. Like I said, friends, next month it'll be 60 years in this church, this wonderful church, this Adventist church. And I thank my mum and dad for bringing me up in this wonderful message. You know what, friends? I'm somewhat educated, not overly educated, just educated enough to get by. And I want to tell you something, friends. Nothing's changed. This truth, nothing has changed in this truth. Man will try to change it, sugarcoat it, dumb it down. But the Word of God never changes. Millions upon millions, friends, 50 million plus, have died for this message, for this truth. I remember C.D. Brooks saying, how dare we expect to go to heaven on fiery beds of ease when 50 plus million sailed through bloody seas? Everyone who believes in Jesus Christ, serves Jesus Christ, or at some time or the other, will suffer persecution in their life. You know, we've matured, we've been enlightened. People are meaner. Yeah, that's true. People are more immoral. That's true. But nothing's changed, beloved. God's law is still a transcript of his character, but it's too high for us. But guess what? He gave us a ladder called grace that we might climb up to. Amen. Beloved, the sanctuary is still in heaven. It isn't going anywhere just because some say so, that it doesn't really exist. The judgment is still going on. God still hates pride. Men are still born into sin. Men must be born again. Dead folk are still dead. Homosexuality is still a sin, regardless of you try to justify it by putting people in officeship and leadership. Still a sin. Christ is still our only Savior, friends. Nothing, no one, none but the righteous shall see God. We've got to be without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. We've got to be covered with his righteousness alone. He still sends the Holy Ghost, and he's still seeking the lost, and he is still saving sinners, my friend. And it is possible to delight ourselves in the Lord and the truth. Beloved, our message is still valid. And if we stand around waiting for our truth to change, we are just exactly like the Protestants who want the Sabbath to change. It ain't going to happen. A gentleman by the name of Jack Sequeira said, if you believe in the Redeemer, you got to start looking more redeemed. Amen? If you believe in the Redeemer, you've got to start looking more redeemed. We're getting to the end, my friend. Let me conclude with the Spirit of Prophecy, my favorite author. Excuse me. Great Controversy, page 461. If you want to read it. She says, the terror of appearing in their guilt and uncleanliness before the searcher of hearts. Who shall deliver me? They saw that nothing but the merits of Christ could suffice to atone. They brought forth fruit, not to fashion themselves after their former lust, but by the faith of the Son of God to follow in his steps, to reflect his character, and to purify themselves as he is pure. The things they once hated, they now loved, and the things that they once loved, they hated. The vain and superficial became serious and obtrusive. The profane became reverent, and the vain fashions of the world were laid aside. Spirit of Prophecy. Friends, I just want to touch lightly on this. You know, I heard last Sabbath about the numbers being increased within Adventism. Yes, that's a fact. I don't want to put a negative on it, but our sister White says, she says, yes, there's a large accessions. This is just another word for increase, rise to the churches. She says, nevertheless, the new members show no corresponding increase of real spiritual life. OBID, page 463. She says, many who join are more willing to deny self and take up their cross than before their conversion. You want to draw a crowd, friends? You give out free Coke and hot dogs. You'll get a crowd. Our religion becomes a sport of infidels and skeptics, she says. Great Controversy once again, 463, 464. Primitive godliness, friends. Sadly lacking, but the time is coming when it will be returned. She says, personal display have banished the thoughts of God. Notwithstanding, nevertheless, friends, you see there is a second statement here. The first one took us negative, and this one takes us positive. She says, notwithstanding, there will be a revival of true primitive godliness. Did you get it, friends? Not a neo-Pentecostalism, but such primitive godliness has not been witnessed since apostolic times. And friends, I also know, she says, when the fires of persecution are rekindled, then you will see a return to a primitive type of godliness which has not been witnessed since apostolic times. Sadly, it will take something like that. And friends, millions down the past have gone through that experience. It's not going to be any different for us. Satan will introduce on the earth, friends, under a religious guise, an emotional excitement, a mingling of the true with the false. But none need be deceived if we would rely on the word of God. Every sinful gratification, my friend, tends to benumb the faculties and deaden the mental and spiritual perceptions, and the word or the spirit of God can make but a feeble impression upon the heart. Suppose you had a baby boy or girl, and as he or she began to grow, and he or she only wanted to eat cake every day, three times a day for the rest of his life, would you comply? Of course not. Beloved, you and I are fellow workers, are God's call facilitators to a pure, more powerful Christian life and to a finished work. And the only reason why God needs us in this church at all is that we might become witnesses to those on the outside. I remember great controversy, she says in there, friends, sensitive, personally, she says, how dare we live a life of ease and acquire lands, houses, bank accounts, etc., etc., while thousands, millions are going down into the grave every day without any hope at all. Where is our sense of duty? Where is our calling, friends? The truth makes a difference. And friends, we will not arrest the world, attention until we are peculiar. And my friend, that does not mean queer. The power that we walk and talk about is in the Word. In the Word, beloved, in the Word. Whose side are you on? Preacher man, once again, shares a testimony. He goes, over in Chicago, there was an old man, an elegant old man. He wore a sports coat like a young guy, drove a yellow Cadillac, brought his beautiful wife. They were both old, but she was beautiful. He said they came to his meetings every night. He never said a word to this gentleman or his wife. They just sat there and listened and went home. And finally, pastor says, we got down to decision time, and this old man walked up by himself and said to me, he says, Pastor, I need to talk to you. And the pastor said, well, let's go aside. They did. And pastor said to him, and now I want you to know for that I do have a problem. Let me replay that again. The old man said to the pastor, he says, now I want to know from you, what should I do about a problem I have? The pastor said, well, what is your problem, sir? The old man said, in my bar, in my basement, I have a lot of good liquor. I want to know what to do with it. Shall I sell it? Shall I give it away? What shall I do? He turned and stared at me. The pastor said, my dear brother, you have a misapprehension. There is no such thing as good liquor. What you probably mean, it's expensive. Now suppose you gave it away or sold it, and that person that received it went out driving drunk and killed a bunch of people or shot his wife. Do you know that you'd bear that responsibility? The book of Habakkuk says, woe unto him that giveth his neighbor drink. 2:15. He then said, what shall I do? The pastor said, I have a suggestion. Make your bathroom a temple and the toilet stool an altar. Bring that expensive liquor up from your basement, set it on the back of the toilet, then kneel down in an act of commitment, give yourself anew to the Lord, and pour it out, that liquor out of the bottle with prayer. He looked at me and sternly said, the pastor said, the old man looked at him and said, if you had told me anything else, I was going to walk out of here. And beloved, pastor says today, 21 years later, his wife sleeps in Jesus and he is still in the truth. Truth wins, beloved. Truth wins. This truth wins souls. You don't need to play games and fool people. This truth with its dignity and power, this truth attended by the Holy Ghost, will win souls of the best kind. In closing, friends, just want to close with a paragraph I hope you're not tired of hearing Spirit of Prophecy. For my favourite author, Ellen White, once again in Manuscript 19 of 1900, she says, "The whole of the gospel is embraced in the third angel's message, and in all our work the truth is to be presented as it is in Jesus. Let nothing lessen the force of the truth for this time. The third angel's message must do its work of separating from the church a people who will take their stand on the platform of eternal truth. Our message is a life and death message, and we must let it appear as it is. The great power of God, we are to present it in its most..." Get this, my friend. "We are to present it in its most telling force. Not with mediocrity, not sugarcoated, not dumb it down, my friend. But we must present it in its most telling force. Then," remember the word "when," "then the Lord will make it effectual." Beloved, let us not compromise our beliefs and standards, but raise them up. Raise them up. And then, only then, will the Holy Spirit do its work. And just like the disciples, what happened? They went out and what? They turned this world upside down under the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. The same, my friend, can happen to you and I. First in Jerusalem, here, your family, your community, and then in Judea and Samaria, and then in the rest of the world. I don't know about you, my friend, but I want my church back. And I pray, beloved, that as the word of God has spoken to your heart this morning, I just pray that the Holy Spirit has convicted you once again of these old truths. Maybe the first time you're hearing some of this, young people, but you cannot deny the word of God. Jesus is coming soon. We need to be serious. Not a gloomy, sad, going around with an unhappy face, because that's not the life of a real Christian. We're not radical, we're not a sect. God has given us the privilege of presenting the truth, and we need to do it in its full entirety, my friend. I pray that God will bless you as you contemplate the Holy Spirit speaking to you this morning. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.